the left believes that any right winger, it wouldn't matter. It wouldn't matter for Williamson or Brett Stevens or me or Ross Dudehat. It does not matter. Okay, anybody who is on the right, Barry Weiss is not even on the white, right? If you are not of the hardcore left, then the left sees you as an improper human being, right? They will not allow you to appear in their pages on a regular basis, or if they do, they will do so extraordinarily grudgingly. It's pretty amazing, and it demonstrates the extremism of the left. In a second, I'm going to explain to you why it is that this has some pretty dramatic ramifications for the entire political discourse, because, you know, Williamson may be an iconoclastic figure. You may not know who he is. You may not care about The Atlantic, but this is an indicator of where our political discourse is going, and it is nowhere good. Here is why this is a problem. You may think that Williamson's crazy. You may hate his viewpoints. You may think that Williamson is garbage. Kevin Williamson, first of all, is a very good writer. Second of all, Kevin Williamson is wildly anti-Trump. When I say he is wildly anti-Trump, I don't mean he just opposed Trump in the election. I mean that he wrote a column when Trump announced called "The Ape Descends the Escalator." I mean that this is a guy who in his columns has called Donald Trump's sons Uday and Kusei. Okay, he is not subtle about his dislike for President Trump. And even he was not acceptable to the left because he has a view on abortion that is outside the mainstream. And as I say, leftist views on abortion, which are inherently outside the mainstream, those are not outside the mainstream, according to The Atlantic. They are just fine. Again, Peter Singer is probably just fine for The Atlantic. But Kevin Williamson is not acceptable. What does this mean? What this means is that the left is doing something really, really damaging to American discourse. They're shrinking the Overton window. Okay, the Overton window, it's a term that I believe was originally used by the VP of a think tank. It was named after him. The Overton window means the range of acceptable discourse. Right. So in any conversation, there's a range of acceptable discourse. There are people who you say are just not acceptable to talk to. You know, people who, for example, say that black people are innately inferior. Right. Those are people who are just not worth talking to. That is not acceptable discourse. Now, this does not mean they don't have a right to say what they want to say. They have a right to say whatever they want to say. It's the First Amendment. Welcome to America. That's fine. But I'm not a moral relativist, and I don't believe that just because you have a right to say something means that you should say it or that everything that is said is equal in value. Okay, so there's something called the Overton window, which is the window of acceptable discourse or useful discourse. But what the left has done is they've shrunk the Overton window down to about pinprick size. Okay, so the Overton window is now the space of opinion between Bernie Sanders and maybe Kamala Harris, right? That's basically the level of acceptable discourse between Ta-Nehisi Coates' intersectional leftism and Bernie Sanders' socialist leftism. Everything in between there is cool. But if you're outside that Overton window, then you are unacceptable. So what does this mean? Well, it means that the left has now separated discourse not into three categories, but into two. So here are the three categories I have for speech. There is the acceptable, there's the unacceptable, right, outside the Overton window. And then there's the acceptable stuff, but I disagree with it. And there's lots of that stuff. I'd say most discourse is stuff that I disagree with, but is within the Overton window. What the left has done instead is they've said there is the stuff we agree with, and then there is everything else. And everything else is unacceptable. So that means that Kevin Williamson is now a deplorable. It means that I am a deplorable. It means that Barry Weiss, a columnist for the New York Times, who I'm sure voted for Hillary Clinton, is a deplorable. It means that people like Brett Stevens and Ross Dudehat, these people are deplorable. It means that, again, Sam Harris is deplorable. Sam Harris and I disagree about a wide variety of things. But Sam Harris once said on national television that Islam is a more dangerous religion than Christianity, and suddenly he was an other. Brett Weinstein, right, a leftist, socialist college professor at Evergreen State College who refused to not teach on a day that the students said we only want non-white teachers teaching. He showed up anyway and wanted to teach. You know, that guy was declared a deplorable because he was outside the acceptable range of windows, right? He was outside the acceptable range of opinions. So what happens when you do this? Well, what happens when you do this is it means that you are lumping in a bunch of people you disagree with unacceptable bigots, right? So now Kevin Williamson is in the same category, according to the left, as Richard Spencer. I'm in the same category as Richard Spencer. You wonder why I get labeled a Nazi by idiots on campus who don't know the first thing about me? Because I am not agreeing with them. Therefore, I am a Nazi. It is that simple. I am not agreeing with them. Therefore, I am part of this basket of deplorables. I am now outside the Overton window, and I must be excluded from the range of acceptable discourse. This is why President Trump is president. This is why, for a short period of time, the alt-right was in the ascendance. The reason is because this leaves people who have now been thrown out of the acceptable range with a choice, right? We can either say, listen, we still think there are three categories, right? Not two, three. We still think that you may disagree with us, but we're in the acceptable category. And so we refuse to allow you to lump us in with people like Richard Spencer. We refuse to allow you to label us a deplorable like some of the other people you're labeling deplorables. Right? You can do that, or you can say, listen, screw you guys. You've now labeled everyone a Nazi. So if you're labeling me a Nazi, I don't know if, I know I'm not a Nazi. Maybe the other people you're labeling Nazis also are not Nazis. Maybe all these bad people who are already out here, maybe they're out here just because you don't like them. Maybe you ought to give their views a second look. Because if you're labeling me the same way you're labeling them, if I get hit with the same category that they're being hit with, then how do I know that you were honest in your original appraisal of those people? And so there's a real temptation on the part of people who have been thrown out of the acceptable category by the left to simply band together and say, listen, we're all in this together because we hate you guys. Right? Because you guys threw us out. We're out here in the cold. You threw us out of the cabin, and now it's snowing. So we can either argue amongst ourselves in the snow, or we can all band together and we can try to break back into the cabin, right? That's sort of the idea that's being pushed here. Now, the moral thing to do would say, listen, we're going to try to break in the cabin without the people we think are bad. We have our own independent viewpoints. I have my own independent viewpoint. And you can try to throw me out of the range of acceptable discourse, but I refuse to accept your label. And I refuse to accept that you're labeling me in the same way that you label a bunch of people who really are disgusting and who really do have disgusting views. But the temptation is going to be always and ever to simply say, listen, you've thrown us all out, alliances of convenience. If you've declared war on us, well, we're not gonna play by the Marcus of Queensbury rules. You declare war on us, we'll take the allies we can get, and we'll fight back against you. The left has been counting on the virtue of conservatives to keep them from making common cause with truly garbage people. But that makes no sense. If you call conservatives garbage people, and then you say, yes, but you really should continue to separate yourself off from the actual garbage people, you can't have it both ways. If we're garbage, then you have to expect us not to act virtuous. Right? This is, you want to know why we're entering into a tribal routine here, why we are getting closer and closer to political tribalism that is going to end poorly for all involved? The reason is because the left has created the anti-left tribe. Okay, that's what's happened. This is why Donald Trump was successful. He didn't campaign as a conservative. He campaigned as an anti-left fighter. And a lot of people said, okay, fine. Well, if he's against them, I'm with him. This is how you generate that. If the left really wanted to have a serious conversation, they wanted to prevent this sort of tribalism, all they have to do is recognize that there are people with whom they disagree that they will still allow to be part of the discourse. And I don't mean people like David Frum, who pretend to disagree with them, but really agree with them on a broad swath of policies. If they continue along these lines, they're really cruising for a bruising. There's going to be a backlash, and it's going to be uncontrollable, and they're not going to like the impact. They're already not liking the impact, because the backlash is already underway.